Para presentarles a quienes están aquí, empezando por Sara Murray en el extremo izquierdo del panel. Sara es periodista, ella contribuye de manera regular al Financial Times y al grupo The Economist, no a la revista, estaba aclarando la hora, sino a una de las ramas del grupo The Economist, que es The Economist Intelligence Unit, que hace un papel realmente interesante de desbrozar la realidad de asuntos complejos como es el de la filantropía, ¿no? Sara ha sido editora de dos libros directamente relacionados con este asunto, ha escrito otros dos libros, entiendo, de cuestiones que no están tan directamente relacionadas, pero conoce muy bien este tema, ¿no? Miguel Castro es el responsable de los partenariados estratégicos de la Fundación Gates con los medios de comunicación. Miguel, con quien nos conocemos también desde hace algún tiempo, conoce no solo por su trabajo en la Gates ahora, sino por su trayectoria con la Open Society Foundation, la Fundación Soros antes de esto, y antes como periodista aquí en Galicia, y conoce muy bien este sector. Sabe muy bien la suerte de círculos virtuosos en los que la filantropía y los medios de comunicación se pueden enganchar para generar beneficios para todas las partes involucradas, ¿no? Y tendremos oportunidad de hablar de todo ello. Y finalmente, Charles Kaidan. Charles es el editor de una revista que se llama The Alliance, que es una revista específicamente dedicada al tema del que estamos hablando, al tema de la filantropía. Charles mismo viene del sector de la filantropía, fue director de una fundación, la Peirce Foundation, entiendo, antes de todo esto, y como en el caso de Sara, está expuesto a través de su trabajo con la Universidad de Stanford, está expuesto, digamos, a algunas de las ideas más innovadoras que están teniendo lugar en este ámbito, ¿no? Bueno, yo les he pedido que sean muy breves, más breves de lo que yo estoy siendo en mi introducción. Vamos a tratar de hacer esto realmente una conversación, tratar de involucrarles a ustedes cuanto antes y esto, como me decía en una ocasión Garrigues Walker, no tenemos ningún derecho a aburrir a nadie, ¿no? Así que vamos a intentar hacerlo y les he pedido una intervención inicial de 5 minutos y después tendremos una conversación. No sé quién quiere empezar. Perdón, y digo otra cosa. A partir de aquí pasamos al inglés, ¿de acuerdo? Toda la conversación la vamos a tener en inglés, también Miguel y yo, para que no tengan que andar quitándose y poniéndose los auriculares, que es muy, muy incómodo, ¿de acuerdo? Sara, if you wish to start, let me start this order, okay? Because we can go with Charles, then with you, and then with Miguel. I think that might be Charles, please.
Sure, thank you. I just prepared a few notes.
Good.
So some of the topics I wanted to just cover very briefly, but first of all, just to say thank you to Foundation Barry and to the Association of Spanish Foundations for not one but two very interesting days talking about the world of Spanish philanthropy and now communications. My key comment that I want to make is an argument that this is a very interesting moment for the relationship between media and philanthropy. On the one hand, for the media, there's great opportunities, and journalists in particular that cover philanthropy, such as myself, great opportunities to tell what is a very interesting story about new philanthropy and the emerging phenomena of philanthropy in a more professional setting. And for philanthropy and for foundations, I think there's a great opportunity to actually assert its identity and its values at a time when there's all sorts of changes taking place socially, politically, and economically. But that opportunity for foundations, including, I suppose, for Spanish foundations, will not be without challenge. And I say this, and I make these comments from my vantage point as editor of a magazine that's specifically focused on philanthropy and social investment, and also, as you said, Gonzalo, as a former director of a family foundation in London. So my observations might be different to, say, a journalist covering from a national newspaper looking at philanthropy. So I just wanted to say that. The other thing I'd also say is that philanthropy is diverse, it's not homogenous, and I'm only making some very general observations at the outset. But I think there's a significant moment for philanthropy, as I said, and I came across this. This is from La Razón, the newspaper here, that was referring to a report by Credit Suisse that says there's going to be, in Spain, an increase of millionaires by 41% by 2021. So an increased growth of wealth and wealth concentration, but at the same time, alongside that, increased inequality, so the gap between rich and poor widening, and in a context, as we know, of great political uncertainty. So that really sets the stage for debates about the role of the state. the role of the public sphere in addressing social issues compared to the private sphere, which includes philanthropy as private effort constituted and directed for public purposes. So what role will philanthropy and foundations play on that stage, given the opportunity? And I think foundations are responding. The question is how quickly and how appropriately. So just a couple of examples of the response and then some reflections on where it leads us before I hand over to you. So we're seeing the emergence of an institutional philanthropy, as the European Foundation Centre calls it, which is a more kind of professionalised, perhaps more specialised, foundation sectors developing new tools, such as communication tools that many of us have been discussing today, and more of a focus on impact, the growth of umbrella bodies. This is the sixth annual conference of the Spanish Foundation, so more work and coordination within and between umbrella bodies, within and between foundation sectors, new tools, new data, new focus on impact, which all suggest some kind of emergence of what we might call loosely a European foundation sector, however fragmented. So where does this leave us? I think it leaves us with more interest in philanthropy in society, and philanthropy taking a more assertive role, what Neil Coleman called earlier foundations maybe wanting to leverage their influence, that is, assert their influence and have more of an influence over society. But there's a flip side to that, and this is one that I just want to reflect on for a moment, and that is, with that greater claim for influence that foundations are asserting will come more scrutiny. And that's why I think it's welcome to hear the president of Foundation Barrier talking about the importance yesterday of accountability, transparency, because I think questions inevitably will arise about the choices that foundations make, the strategies on which they base those choices. Say, why Barrier spent 6 million euros on the renovation of Santiago de Compostela, as opposed to the opportunity cost of how they make those choices. And I'm not making a comment about whether the legitimacy of those choices, just the fact that those choices will be under more scrutiny. Or, for example, take the case of the Gates Foundation, spending $3 billion US dollars a year or more, but the concentration in governance terms of a small number of family members and one non-family member at the head of the foundation. So questions about governance, questions about strategy that inevitably will be asked. There may well be, and indeed there are good answers, but I think the era of transparency is upon us. And then finally, I've just closed by making a few observations about where this leaves the media at a time of uncertainty for the media. I'm relatively new to journalism, but my understanding is that the revenue models for media are increasingly under pressure through loss of subscriptions, questions about advertising revenues, and some see philanthropy as a panacea or a solution, that philanthropy can start funding the media or the philanthropy media or the non-profit media that I'm in. And I think it's welcome to see new partnerships emerge, but I'd also be caution my colleagues in the media about being careful what we wish for, because I think there's several risks. One is a risk of self-censorship in terms of the content that is produced. I think there's a risk also of the narrowing of the scope of editorial and journalistic inquiry if there have to be conversations about with funding partners about how that relationship might emerge. And I think also there's this fundamental question about who's going to ask the critical questions about philanthropy, and that requires a degree of independence and, in some cases, courage. But I think it's important if the quality of the public debate on philanthropy is going to be improved, and I think that quality is sometimes not as advanced and is sometimes a bit more lacking. So it's really welcome to be having this conversation now about the relationship between philanthropy and the media.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Charles. You stick very well to the 5 minutes. Sarah, please, if you can. Muchas gracias.
Thank you. So I hope, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
So, just 2 points. A little bit about what I write about, because I don't purely cover philanthropy, but that doesn't mean that I'm not talking to foundations a lot. So when I cover philanthropy, I'm really looking at, developments in philanthropy. I think, as you said, it's an interesting moment because gone are the days where philanthropists just wrote checks and kind of let things happen. There's much more of a sort of giving while living and being much more hands-on involved in strategic philanthropy, as we call it, which makes this a very much more interesting time to be writing about that because, of the choices that are being made in philanthropy. But also, my work for the Financial Times and the Economist Group, I'm also writing about issues like healthcare, like food sustainability, like business and the environment. And in those kind of contexts, what I end up doing is really, you know, speaking to experts from different fields, and that would include the philanthropic field. We all heard Neil Coleman this morning talking about the Resilient Cities Program. Well, I've done a lot of writing about cities and future resilience, and so obviously organizations like the Rockefeller Foundation end up being very good sources for what I'm writing about. So there's a huge amount of sort of expertise that resides in the philanthropy. You know, it's not just about giving money, it's about doing studies, it's about having experts in their fields, and those are pretty critical, you know, infrastructure that foundations can offer to journalists. And then I would say also just in terms of what are we looking for as journalists from foundations? So part of it is this expertise, is the ability to talk on a wide range of subjects and have a large amount of expertise. But when it comes to writing about philanthropy and the strategic philanthropy, and for example with the Stanford Social Innovation Review, I quite often profile organizations and the choices that they're making and the different, you know, sometimes they're going through big changes and I would write about that. One thing I'm looking for, Charles, you mentioned transparency. One thing that's very difficult for a journalist is to get people to admit to their biggest mistakes. and I've said, I would say this even more true with the corporate sector, which I've spent a lot of time writing about business sustainability, so I'm all the time speaking to companies. And, people are very, very reluctant to share their biggest mistakes. You could sort of see possibly that the corporate sector might argue, well, you know, we've got our share price to worry about, so we can't start talking about how bad we've done at something. But that's not true of the philanthropic sector, and it seems to me that there's a huge, gap in sort of transparency and sharing best practice that could actually advance philanthropy, but also, you know, is something that journalists clearly look for. We never want to write a story that says, oh, we did everything marvelously and we succeeded hugely and that's the end of the story. You know, as journalists, what we're looking for are what are the really big challenges out there? What were the stumbles that we made along the way trying to resolve this challenge? And then what are the solutions that we found worked? So I would really stress to all organizations that kind of sort of honesty and warts and all kind of openness is really what will make good journalism and what will you know enable voices from the philanthropic world to be heard more in the media. And then finally, on the other point, which I think we're probably going to end up talking quite a lot about, as somebody who's been in journalism for 20 years and has watched the business model crumble and has wondered what is going to happen, you know, to democracy if we don't have journalism, I do think that philanthropy has a huge role to play because, you know, if philanthropists are promoting an equal democratic society, that society cannot exist without the media. But I think the big questions are, how do you do that? And that goes back to some of the things that Charles was saying, is that, you know how you fund media and through philanthropy is going to be critical. There won't be one model that works for all, but I do think it's something that a debate that needs to be started and with some urgency because newspapers, I mean, I live in the States, local newspapers across the States have been, you know, going bankrupt. And one could argue that, for example, the Flint water poisoning scandal, whereby millions have been left with health problems as a result, that came at the same time as local newspapers were dying like flies. And one might argue that had there been more robust journalism, that this big social issue might have been uncovered much earlier. So I would just say that brings us to this ever closer role between philanthropy and journalism because the role of journalists is so critical, it needs to be funded somehow. So with that, I'll move on.
Very good. Sarah, thank you so much. I think that very interesting issues are arising. I think that the business model is stuff that I think Miguel is going to touch on as well. And I'm very interested on the scrutiny and what are the trade-offs between the, which I think is, but Miguel, please.
Can you hear me? Yeah? Does it work? Yes. So I'm going to make three very quick in a small point, and the second point, it relates very much to that. And these are, again, as Charles says, it's a very complex world, and sometimes we're sort of simplifying the message just to be understood, but James Dean, who's the director of research at the BBC Media Action, said something the other day that left me thinking about it, is that misinformation, and he just gave a case, misinformation kills. So that to understand the role of media. Where I see the relationship between philanthropy and media as it most dysfunctionally is in how philanthropy generally has used media in a very utilitarian way mm-hmm. as a tool. If you look at the charitable giving in the U.S., which is around $358 billion a year, out of which 59 of that comes from private foundation, the amount of money that goes to media is so small that it's not even codified. Would you ask that question, how much of that money goes to media? No one knows because it's so small that there is no even a line in the coding. In Europe, there's more than 141,000 foundations, investments of more than 60 billion euros, mm-hmm. and the number of foundations that support media as its role in society to inform citizens to make the better choices and to, as someone said before, improve the plurality of the public debate, is a handful. We know them all by name. And the global development industry, who is $138 billion, who tries to eradicate diseases, who tries to end poverty, build equality across societies, that has codified the investments on media and is something around $400 million out of $138 billion, out of which only 178 go to media outlets, to journalism and storytelling and the ways that people use to keep foundations accountable, keep governments accountable to the instruments where the storytelling sort of engages audiences on these issues. So it's minuscule. It's so tiny that it's quite painful. So the good thing about that is that the opportunity is only to grow. I leave that point in that optimistic note. The other point I want to make is a fairly obvious one, but I want to give it a tweak, and it's the theories of agenda setting. So everyone works on the assumption that, as someone said before, comunicación transforma. I think it was Jesús sitting in this sofa. And it's true, you know, the agenda setting theory, which is like hundreds of scientific social science research on the influence of media, says that news media has the ability to influence the salience of topics, which it makes what is important for people very clear. What it doesn't work so well, and at least we don't know how to, is what people do think about those topics. It's not just about the metric of the volume of I am reaching a lot of people, but it's when you reach that people, what do they think about that? What is their attitude to that topic? What is their perception about that topic? And ultimately, what is their behavior? So are they learning something that they're going to do and change their social behavior mm-hmm. on all of the causes that we as foundations try to work and drive in society? So that transformation with media attention to the point that sometimes we measure coverage and volume and we equate that to we're doing well and sometimes even to brand mentions of not the topics that we care about but the names of our foundations. That's an obsession that I find really dangerous, pretty clear in the US, coming to Europe basically because of the influence of communications tactics that come from the private sector, right. like branded journalism or native advertising, etc. Mm-hmm. There is an influence that has on trust for private foundations who operate on a charitable sector for a public good mm-hmm. that is fairly counterproductive, and there is a little bit of research on that. And my last point is about something that I learned yesterday. There is only, I don't know who said it, but there is only 7% of foundations in Europe have online presence. And it's clear that foundations...
Sorry? 7%?
7%.
Only 7 have online presence.
Online presence. in the United States.
But what do you mean by online presence?
So a website.
Is that so?
Of Facebook page and social. Someone said it yesterday here. And it's true, and it's important that foundations have presence.
Right.
And it's an issue of transparency and accountability and a voice. You as a social investor have to have a voice, and it's all perfectly relevant. But we need to be very, very careful, and I would love to discuss that, and I throw it out there, is to make sure that we know when the brand is an enabler of influence and not an obstacle of influence.
Right.
And we operate as the default as my brand is going to be an enabler, and it's my job to make the brand and the name of my founder present. But that's not the case in many occasions. Sometimes the brand is an obstacle, especially because I think that communications efforts works best when you have audience at the core of your users, at the core of your messaging, at the core of your storytelling. And if you do that, your brand is an obstacle most of the time because of the all of the complexities of what the brand capital mean, the risk, the reputation, the associations, the biases, etc. So just a word of caution about thinking that is an obligation, that is the default position to brand your philanthropy, your foundation. It's not always the case. Sometimes the name has to be aside, especially if you're user-centric. I think it was Sebastián who said his sentence was, las organizaciones no hacen cosas para contarlas. Organizations do things just to tell the story about them. They do them because they mean something, but it certainly doesn't look like when you look at how foundations operate in communications in the US and Europe.
Absolutely. But it is true that although there is a trade-off, we were just, I mean, in the previous round table with the communications directors, the incentives that senior staff have very often in this regard are related to the brands. Nobody has an incentive for an informed public conversation on child poverty or an informed public conversation on global health, because that is very difficult to measure. I was very interested to hear Jesus before saying how La Caixa monetizes the appearances. So this is something that they follow very, very closely. No? My question to you is, how do we avert this risk? How do we get the best of the relationship between the media and the philanthropy? I think, Sarah, you were very explicit in terms of how the business model is transitioning in the media. We still don't know how this is going to evolve. Not even the New York Times, the most relevant media, know how to respond to this question. And it is increasingly clear that the philanthropy is going to play a role on that. It might not be the only financier, but it's going to play a role. Certainly for the many organizations that we work with, small independent media in Latin America, for instance, or the Texas Tribune in the US, or many other, some of the best media organizations, even small, it's only philanthropy that is playing a role. No? My question to you is, how do you get the best of that relationship without falling into the traps of self-censorship and brands and the hidden advertisements or a different... Do you have an example of where this is working well?
I mean, I think that there have to be different models. And I don't know what the right ones are for the right circumstances, but I think what philanthropy and the media, the people that are working together on these kinds of relationships, have to think about is, there are various scenarios. So you could say, right, well, we care about water pollution in urban areas. So we're going to fund a journalist specifically to go and investigate that and write the story. That you could say could be very valuable. The danger with, maybe you need some of that, but the danger with becoming too specific is that journalism needs just people to go out and poke around and find things, and they may not even be able to say we've got a story at the beginning. Where do you find the funding for that? You can't brand a foundation with like, I'm just going to go and send my investigative reporters right. out to do things. So I think the other thing is, do you say, well, okay, as a foundation, we're just going to sort of fund the back office operations right. of this media. So I think there are very many different models, and we need to really start a conversation about which are appropriate where.
Right.
And one thing, if I touch upon that, one thing that needs to happen is that when a journalist or someone from the media talks about these new models, one of the assumptions, one of the defaults is that the media industry has to be there as an element of that equation. But when we really, this sound like might sound a little bit controversial, but we really need to start thinking about models in which the media industry is not one of the elements, as it happened to the music to the music industry. And because at the end of the day, when we think about audiences, we think about the people who consume any storytelling. Really, people consume stories. They don't really care if they come from an institution that is well structured, that has a 100-year history, or if it comes from a platform that is built only a decade ago. People consume stories. Same as happened to the music industry. People consume songs. They didn't care about the music industry.
But the danger is the false news we've had. I mean, that comes from another platform. So you do need a respected media outlet, because otherwise how are you going to know where the verity is?
No, absolutely. You need a proper public debate that is informed, that is intelligent, and that is based on evidence. Is that done by journalism alone? Is a question, because no one outside of the journalism industry, no one cares about journalism as much as we do. So we need to start thinking about the relationships with the platforms, which tend to be pretty controversial. But the platforms are the entities that put the content on people's phones and laptops and iPads. So.
I think this is very interesting. I will go back to you now, Charles. The question about the role of the intermediary and how that is evolving as well. And this is happening in our sector. It is happening in many other ways. No, but and here in this meeting we have very interesting people that are experimenting with new projects such as The Conversation, that are doing the kind of journalism that is different from what we used to see, and that is actually opening. Opening information in a completely different way from what we... Sorry, Charles, please, go ahead.
I agree with that. No one cares about journalism as much as journalists, but probably no one cares about philanthropy as much as we do, to answer your question, but from the point of view of my work, which is philanthropy media covering philanthropy, I think the challenges about independence are even harder. How can a philanthropy media cover philanthropy in a way that's reflective, analytical and independent? So just to give a reference to what we do at Alliance, because I think it's relevant in the context of this conversation, is we have some advertising, some subscriptions, and then we have foundations who support our work, but it's the cross-section and diversity of right. foundations that support our work that provide their own checks and balances, because there's no one organisation in overall control. That said, if I want to write about some of the foundations that support us, I think I'd be unhuman not to have in my mind some of the implications of that of what I write and how I write, and I'll try my best to avoid that influencing what I write or what I think about what I might write, but it's going to be present. So one solution in the context that I sit in might be for any foundations that are concerned about pluralism in civil society and the health of the foundation sector to be willing to invest in, say, an endowment for philanthropy media. That endowment might not necessarily have to be an Alliance endowment, Alliance being a charitable trust, so it could be, but it could be just generally to any institutional set of institutions that want to make a commitment to a longer-term effort to actually build the base for foundation media. But to do that, one would have to trust that media organisation, its performance may vary over time.
Absolutely.
But this relates to the question about to what extent can foundations trust others and place that trust
Absolutely.
And be willing to shift that power, which may come back to bite them, depending on who's the editor and what they might want to investigate.
This is a very practical idea.
We talk a little bit, though, about sort of conflict of, you raised the issue of conflict of interest, and do we start to have journalism influenced by the funders that are funding it? I mean, let's not forget that, you know, media has been funded by advertising mainly, and so, you know, maybe there is, maybe we have to think about what was that, how did that model work, and how did the advertisers not influence, and in a lot of cases maybe they did. I mean, I certainly know from the Financial Times' point of view that there is this absolute sort of iron, you know, steel wall between the advertising teams and the editorial teams, to the extent that actually when I was on staff at the Financial Times, I used to edit some of the supplements, and we were not allowed to know who the advertisers were. And actually, often we would celebrate when the advertiser would ring in the next day and say, well, I think you were very unfair in your right. coverage of this company. But that for us was a win, because it meant that in the days when advertising worked. But I do think we need to think about, again, there are different models, and how do you create that that barrier?
Thank you, Sarah. I want to take the conversation down to the floor. I don't know if there are questions or comments. Perdón, si hay comentarios. Bueno, tienen los casos, ¿no? Si hay comentarios o preguntas que quieren hacer, anímense. Yo sé que hay gente en el público que tiene opiniones muy firmes sobre este asunto, que está absolutamente abierto a la opinión, ¿no? Bueno, piénsenselo mientras, in the meantime, I have a question for you. Particularly for you, Miguel. How do you compare Spain in this landscape with other countries? Do you think that it was very interesting what Charles quoted from La Razón about the way, the number of people that might have the potential to intervene in this sector right now in our country, and they are not necessarily doing that. And also, we are here in the middle of a meeting of the main organizations and foundations doing philanthropy. Do you think that we are like other countries, or we are worse or better?
So as far as I know, there is no philanthropy support for media. There is philanthropists who own media, but not philanthropy right. support for media in the traditional way. One thing that Spain has that not many other countries have is a very strong and supportive public opinion of social issues and media covering social issues
right.
and high levels of consumption of media when reporting on social issues and social issues in the largest possible sense. And there is one case that I know very well because we have a current project with them, which is El País, a section called Planeta Futuro. El País has traditionally been very interested on the issues that we care about as Gates Foundation, which have to do with poverty eradication, gender equality, public health and global health, etc. But through our funding, similarly as Rockefeller was explaining before, we enable media organizations to do more and better and more engaging coverage about these issues that are very complex and very difficult and not very attractive many times. And what is incredibly surprising, especially if I compare it with the performance of other media organizations across the world, is the reach and the influence at the conversation level of the content. Navigate socially very well. The audience numbers are huge, including your own blog, Gonzalo. Right. And there is a public sphere in Spain because of the tradition of solidarity
right.
that is sort of the beautiful playing ground for more of that, as opposed to other countries that we work or that I know, where public opinion and support to empathy, support to social issues is in sharp decline.
Right, absolutely.
In very sharp decline.
Absolutely.
And we monitor 19 to 20 social issues, and sometimes poverty abroad ranks 19 or 20 in many countries that I don't want to name, as opposed to Spain, where poverty abroad still ranks fairly high.
Yeah.
So that's the only difference. But as probably everyone knows in this room, I don't know of any foundation who has a program or any strategy of supporting media to inform public debate.
Right. Charles, I don't know, or Sarah, you want to say something on this? No? Take the microphone.
Oh, yes. I mean, I do think that I think in the States one has a growing interest in among the philanthropic world in playing a role in these debates, and so I do think that's very encouraging. I think that, as I say, I think the philanthropic world is going to be on a learning curve as to how to engage, as to how best to engage with the media, particularly given that the media itself is in radical transformation, and that we're moving from, you know, established newspapers like the FT to blogs and Facebook. I think it's going. I do think there would be a very interesting role for some kind of, you know, guiding force in all of this, to say, well, where do we go? Because we're really in uncharted territory. But I think there is a growing interest, and I certainly see that in the US.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. We have a question. José Kunz. José himself is a blogger here in La Voz de Galicia, and I think it's a very, very interesting perspective. No, no sé. No.
A ver, ahora sí. Nada, no se escucha.
No, dilo si quieres y yo les traigo. Vale. Ahora sí.
Sí, ahora, bueno, digo, sí, la cuestión sería, hablando de eso que hablaban de evidencia, de ahora estamos observando también aquí, como en otros sitios, que cada vez hay, vía blogs, vía redes sociales, cada vez nos ocurren organizaciones que no es solo ya la comunicación oficial de las organizaciones de fundaciones la que manda, es la que realmente se crea la causa, la que difunden sus empleados, sus voluntarios, su público objetivo, no solo noticias de la organización, sino sobre la misma causa. Y en ese positivo hay aspectos positivos de que se puede conseguir difundir causas que antes no estaban en el carril político. Yo creo que pobreza, que hablaba hace un momento Ramón Castro, es algo que en España tiene mucho que ver la movilización en redes sociales y que se haya planteado un medio de comunicación alternativo, pero me preocupa ver su opinión. ¿Cómo se relaciona eso con ese factor que hablaba de evidencia, de perseguir cuál es la relación de los medios tradicionales con este tipo de comunicación y también en las propias organizaciones? Si se creen que la información a partir de redes sociales o blogs es válida o por lo menos si tiene algún aspecto creíble a la hora de actuar o contrastarla de alguna forma.
Do you understand in Spanish or no?
Bueno.
So the question, just to be very, very brief, is about the relevance of social networks in terms of feeding the information of the media, and to what extent a debate that sometimes is very intense, it does drive part of the way the media looks at the information, and to what extent it's trustworthy, it's something credible that can be taken into. Yep. Do you have an opinion on this?
So I can say this is one thing on the basis of my experience in the work with organizations such as Alto Analytics, will be in the stage later. So one thing is, it's very clear, is that still, despite the level of conversation at the social level, it's fragmented and comes from all places, and people express themselves in different ways. Still the authority and influence of media, traditional media, on those conversations is fairly high. When you analyze what people use as a unit of authority to be part of those conversations, what they share, what they add to their link in Twitter, etc., a fairly high percentage tend to be a media from a traditional trusted source of information. And we know that from research in different countries, in different languages, and in different contexts. So we shouldn't assume that because the conversation happens in social and is by individuals who are not attached to institutions or the traditional unit that originated that is not. In social research, what we do a lot is the concept of share of voice. So the share of voice of traditional media organizations in those debates is pretty high. It's surprisingly high. So just to mention that we shouldn't assume that those conversations don't happen because of traditional media or influencers or yeah.
Thank you. Sarah, very briefly,
yes.
And I don't know, Charles, if you want to close, because now they are making me obscene signs from the side that we have to...
I'll be very brief. I think the one word that stuck out for me in what you're saying there is conversation. Yeah. And I do think that social media has played this huge role in making conversations happen. But I think that where we just need to not forget the role of media, and this is again where we need some sort of funding, is that conversations are not what sends somebody to Afghanistan to go and report on a war, or somebody who's going to spend 4 weeks investigating a company. So, you know, social media is the conversation, but there needs to be that the resources for that kind of research.
I think that's a very good.
And I would just end by saying that, you know, on this day of foundation communications, it's been emphasised how accountability, communication are good for foundations. And if that's the case, then the media should and will and must continue to have a role in providing at least one forum or one platform for that accountability. So I hope we can all agree on that, and that will contribute to a more vibrant foundation and philanthropic sector.
Thank you. Bueno, Sara, Miguel, Charles, muchísimas gracias. Y les animo a seguirles en Twitter, a seguir las conversaciones que ellos y otros como ellos están continuando. Este es un tema absolutamente central, que, como decía Miguel, todavía nuestro país está por desarrollar, pero yo espero que en el futuro esta conversación continúe de una manera mucho más sofisticada. Así que muchísimas gracias y gracias por la invitación.
Thank you,
Sarah.